All right, guys, welcome back to another edition of Raw Intuition Inside Scoop. We've got another really great guest for you today. We've got Professor Spira, who is a Mucusless Diet Healing System practitioner and expert. He's the webmaster of mucusfreelife.com, founder of Mucus-free Life LLC, which publishes several books of Arnold Arendt and other authors. He also has an annotated version of the Mucusless Diet Healing System, Rational Fasting, as well as a book, Spira Speaks. So I just want to bring Professor Spira onto the channel and have him kind of explain to us what the Mucusless Diet Healing System is, how it has affected his life and those around him that he knows that are practicing this diet style slash healing system, and just kind of go over the basics and the principles of this system. So, Professor Spira, thanks a lot for joining us. It's a pleasure to have you.
Greetings. It's a pleasure to be here.
Thank you. All right. So, you know, I guess we could just start off. Who was Arnold Arendt, and what is the Mucusless Diet Healing System that he came up with?
All right. So, Arnold Arendt was born in Germany, Baden, Germany, in 1866. And growing up, he had some health issues, and he was diagnosed with what they considered to be an incurable disease. When you say they, you know, we're talking about the burgeoning medical establishment. You know what? And I wouldn't call it established in the way that it is today, but it was kind of getting its start back then. And this is over in Europe, and he was fairly young and really, really sick, and he wanted to find a remedy. He had a little bit of money from his family, and so he went to a lot of the different places of healers and sort of formal doctors and practitioners at the time, and nobody could heal him. You know, nobody found any kind of remedy for him. Really, not even any relief in that side. So he started to investigate plant-based healing, and at the time there was the very beginning of a back-to-nature renaissance. This was really big in Switzerland, Germany. This is the same back-to-nature renaissance that essentially came to America, to Southern California, developed and then sort of exploded as a pop cultural phenomenon in the 60s, but we can get to that later. But Arendt, basically, he started to check out some of these vegetarian retreats, and there were a number of people kind of pushing fruit diets and all this kind of stuff. And he would go to some of these retreats or some of these practitioners, and he would get a little bit of relief. And it'd be like, okay, well, I'm feeling better, but this really isn't doing it. And so it got to the point where he was almost just ready to give up. And so by some kind of, intervention or whatever, he just kind of said, you know what, I'm just going to stop eating. I'm not, if I die, I die, whatever. Yeah. I'm just not going to eat anything. And to his surprise, within 2 weeks, he had started to get a lot better. He was feeling better than he had felt in years. And he noticed, he's like, wait a minute, I haven't eaten anything and I'm starting to heal. And the brilliance of Arendt, he started kind of putting it together, like, okay, well, that, because he, you know, obviously heard about fasting and things, but nobody had really developed a systematic way to do it. A lot of these different systems, whether you would go to whatever the practitioners were back then, I mean, it's almost as diverse as it is now. You know, you look out there and it's just everybody sort of has their own opinion and has their own book and has their own retreat and all that kind of stuff. And it was kind of like that then. But he just kind of put it together in his head. It's like, okay, well, I think this is what works. You know, this is how you can heal someone. And he noticed that there was basically two different kinds of foods. All foods either were foods that did not turn into slime, which he called mucus, or they were foods that would turn into slime. Once you put it in the body, if you heat it up, it turns into this sort of viscous, gooey substance that we call mucus. And he reasoned, well, wait a minute, then if the slimy food is the food that sort of causes the ailments in me, and then it's the, it causes ailments in other people that I see, then is this really human food? Are we supposed to be eating slime-producing, mucus-forming foods? And as he started to, and you know, after he healed himself, he opened up, he worked at a couple places where he essentially started to hone his healing methods in the Mucus-free Diet Healing System. He ultimately did have his own sanitariums, one, or at least one that was in Europe. And then when he came over to America in, it was 1915, but I had to take a look, but around that time it was like World War One. So he intended on going back home, but he, because of the war, he couldn't. So he had to stay in America, and that's when he, you know, hooked up with some of the people he hooked up with in America. You know, Fred Hirsch and you know, Benedict Luss, who he had already worked with a little bit earlier, and so he was just at the forefront of this entire movement. There was a lot of people that was investigating, you know, the raw foodism and fruitarianism and, you know, vegetarianism. Of course, the word vegan wasn't invented yet. And so there was a lot of infighting in these organizations because there's people that they wanted to keep eating their pus-forming foods, which are meat and dairy and the fish. Like, well, I want to call myself, that doesn't even make any sense. I want to call myself vegetarian, but fish is okay, you know, fish and eggs. Like, I don't know what, you know, what garden your egg and fish grew out of didn't make a whole lot of sense. But so essentially, in America, arid actually really starts to get, you know, fairly popular, especially sort of again that back to nature vibe that was going on in Southern California, and he was just sort of this iconic figure. And, you know, toward the end of his life, he was selling out these big rooms where everybody would in that day, pay $100 to see him speak, which today that would be like $1,000 or more or something. So, he was getting real popular, and he, you know, he met a tragic end. Nobody knows for sure what happened. It's all real fishy, as we might say, where nobody saw him die. They say he got a basal fracture. He was leaving a sold-out presentation that he had just did, a lecture he had just did. It was totally sold out, killed it. And he was walking across the street, as the story goes, a slick street, had new shoes on, and supposedly fell and fell on the back of his head and had a basal fracture. But a lot of us that, you know, Mucus-free Diet practitioners and, you know, followers of Eric, we don't really, we just think that that's not, that doesn't make a whole lot of sense. And nobody saw it, so there's something a little fishy about that. But, so then after he did pass, and Fred Hirsch kind of took up the mantle of Eric Publishing, made sure that Eric's work continued to be out there. He opened up a fairly popular retreat, you know, kind of plant-based retreat in it was California. And people like Einstein, I mean, there was a lot of famous people that would go there. Einstein went there. Some other, you know, famous actors and this kind of stuff. And so so Arid is, he's been an elite figure, or a figure that elites know about.
Right.
There, you'd be surprised on who knows about it. I mean, to this day, people don't realize they sit down at an Apple computer that is directly influenced by the work of Professor Arnold Arid, because Steve Jobs was an Arid fiend early in his life, in that real creative period. when he was putting that company together. And so, you know, so Eretz really had a major influence, much more so than most people would ever realize or really give him the credit for, because when people read his work, some of the things that he says and the propositions he makes are so controversial that even people that respect him and like him, like, yeah, I really like most of what he says, but there's a few things he says that really gets on people's nerves, and they're just like, oh man, I can't promote him, you know, I can't, like, I want to like him, but I can't, because there's certain things he says that just really goes against everything that people like to teach about when it comes, whether you're talking about nutrition or other, some of these other theories, you know, so just, you know, real controversial figure, one that they have tried to bury, the historians and the people that, I mean, you shouldn't get out of, you know, a medical history of medicine or a history of naturopathy or anything without, you know, Eretz coming up in the discussion, but they've done a good job of, you know, kind of keeping him suppressed, because it's so powerful, and you can't get, he doesn't promote a lot of the things that most people in this field make money from selling. There's a lot of people make money, you know, selling the herbs or selling supplements or the vitamins or this or that. And he was very much, and he's not opposed to rational use of herbs, you know, so I get that straight. But the focus is always on the diet, transition, and fasting. And then we can sort of talk about what I call the ancillaries, you know, the exercise and the enemas and the whatever it is, you know, all the different, the massage and, you know, whatever, you know, we can get into things that can aid the elimination process, but the body heals itself. You know, you can't take something that's going to heal the body.
Exactly.
So that's pretty much, you know, Professor Arnold Eretz. You know, I got into the Mucus-free diet about 14 years ago. And I was 280 pounds, or I was actually probably about 300 pounds. Because I'd even gained a little more. Well, I was 280 for a long time, and then right before I got into the diet, things got pretty bad. And I was way up there. I was real close to 300 pounds, and just suffered from a lot of ailments. I had, you know, chronic migraine headaches almost every day, and sleep apnea. I was using a little oxygen mask thing when I'm sleeping, and I used to snore real just crazy loud, and just overall, you know, bad health. But I didn't know that it could be any different. I thought that it was normal to take pharmaceutical medications every day of my life for the rest of my life, because I'd been taking them since I was 7 years old. And everybody in my family, from, you know, my mother who died when I was in sixth grade, and my aunt, and everybody I knew took medicine. So that was almost like a rites of passage to become an adult. Like, I feel, you know, older, and because I'm taking pills, and it's like
kids that start drinking coffee.
Exactly.
Because they see their parents drinking coffee.
Exactly. And, so pretty much within 6 months, I lost about 100 pounds and overcame the most intense of those ailments. You know, I stopped using the CPAP unit. I stopped getting sick all the times. I used to just always be sick, just be blowing my nose all the time, and that kind of thing. And so I basically, you know, got over that, and just kept going. I didn't stop. I was like, this is going to be my path, and decided to really, really go down it and see what's on the other side.
Yeah. Wow. See, that right there that you just covered, I mean, that should be enough to get everybody to read this book, you know, read about Arnold Eretz and what he's accomplished. But like you said, his information has somewhat been suppressed, and, you are using your website and YouTube to get his message out. So how has that been going?
It's been going really good. I've been really excited to see, especially young people. There's a lot of young people, teenagers and young people in their, you know, early 20s, and A lot of young people are starting to check out the book, check out the lifestyle. Because I really, I can say the name of the organization, Mucus-Free Life, the Mucus-Free Lifestyle. That's really what I like to really focus on, because it's really not just a diet, you know, where it's like, well, what do I got to eat? It's like, well, I mean, we can talk about that, but there is also a philosophy that goes with it, a whole way of looking at the world that's a lot different from these other lifestyles and traditions. You know, it's a very unique kind of experience and mode of life to be in. But yeah, things are going really good. The main thing is challenging, because I'm pretty much kind of by myself. A lot of the stuff I'm doing, I have to do it all. So I disappear for a while, and people's like, where's Spira at? You told us that this was going to be, because I'll say something's going to come out, like, yeah, something's coming out next month. And it'd be like a year later, where's this thing at? I'm like, I'm sorry. I just, you know, the time. So I just look at it like it's like that now, but in 10 years, it's just, nobody will even know about all this process of sort of building things. But I wanted to build a foundation of a new culture and a new community. And in order to do that, it just takes a long time. It's different than if you're just trying to sell a product. If you're just trying to make some money and sell a product, you do something way different than what I've been trying to do, you know. But if you really want to try to build a community of people that can support each other and kind of educate people to a whole new way of thinking, then it takes some time. Definitely takes some time.
Well, that's good stuff. So I guess it would be fitting to go over what are mucus forming foods. You know, what is the mucusless diet? What do you eat on this diet?
So the mucusless diet, as a strict definition, would possibly be different from the mucusless diet as a healing system, you know, mucusless diet healing system. So a mucus-free or mucusless diet strictly would be mucus-free fruits and mucus-free vegetables. And so that is going to basically be the fruits that have the least amount of fat in them, and vegetables that have, you know, basically no starch or no fat associated with them. You know, those are total mucus-free foods. But we don't try to get people to just eat like that right off the bat. That's something a lot of people want to try to put that in their mind, especially if they're coming from some of these other more strict sort of avenues, whether it be there's, you know, certain raw food communities or certain, you know, fruitarian aspirants, and there's these different communities where they're just really strict about a certain principle, like this principle: if you don't do this, then you're not in the club anymore, you know. And what we try to say is, look, like we're about incremental change and transition. So you're just, because you ate some processed vegan food one day, you're like, you're not out the club. That's part of your transition. That's part of your relapse process. If you understand how to transition properly, you keep moving forward. You know, you don't sit there and be all, feel sorry for yourself or be hard on yourself or guilty or anything like that. Once you know the principles of the system, you keep moving forward. So that's, you know, all the stuff, your basic, your fruits, your melons and your berries and, you know, all that kind of stuff. The fatty fruits, I'm not, you know, a fan of those can be mucus forming, the avocados and all that kind of stuff, which I know that just makes some people cry. They just
don't want to hear that.
You know, and it's like, I'm not telling you to not eat it, just because it can be part of your transition if you eat it properly. I'm just saying, be mindful that that's not a mucus-free item, no matter how much you try to make it. I mean, you can, no, but when I ate it, it was like, no, look, I'm just, it's fine that you eat it, but I'm just saying it's not mucus-free. Because just compare, take the meat of an avocado and take the meat of a watermelon and cook both of them as an experiment and tell me what happens to the watermelon and what happens to the avocado. The watermelon, yeah. The watermelon is so, I mean, you're pretty much, you could probably boil it away. There would be so little bit of anything left. But that avocado is going to cook down into a slimy, viscous, mucusy sludge.
Yeah.
So, and you can do that with any food item if you really wanted to do your own test to see, well, what is mucus forming and not mucus forming. And it's not meant to be a scientific test. It's just more of an empirical kind of deductive test. If you can kind of, okay, well, I deduce if I cook it down and it turns into slime here, kind of like what you would do with rice. You know, they make bookbinders glue out of rice. And if you cook rice long enough, it just turns into glue.
Right.
And so it's the same with a lot of other mucus forming foods. So we say mucus forming foods as a umbrella term, but it can further be divided into mucus forming foods and pus forming foods.
Mm.
So pus forming foods indicate any food item that involves dead, decaying flesh or decaying blood, like white blood. And so that's going to be your meat and your dairy. Those are pus forming, and pus is a very concentrated form of mucus. You know, if you use, you know, mucus as the umbrella term, so it's very concentrated. Yeah. And that's why, you know, it's so dangerous to eat it. And that is one of the items that we say, you know, get off of as soon as you can. Now, with me, you know, it took me a while to totally get off of meat. You know, there was a couple months where I was still kind of eating it a little bit, and I really wasn't totally committed to the system yet, and I wasn't doing all the different components of the mucus diet healing system. And but once I got kind of past those couple months, I was cool for a while, yet I still wasn't out of the woods. You know, I would kind of go back every now and then. So it took me about a total of 6 months where I was totally meat and dairy free. So I do that, say that just to get in perspective, because a lot of people I work with, most people I work with, I mean, they were able to get off of meat and dairy faster than I did, which is beautiful. I'll tell my story just so if it's hard for you to not get discouraged, you just got to keep working the system, and eventually you'll get there, because as long as those poisons are still in your system, you're going to crave them. But as soon as you really get rid of that stuff out of you, then you'll no longer crave, you know, those poisons. And you'll get to the point where if you try to eat it, it'll make you sick. You'll know. You eat it, you're just like, okay, that was a bad idea. And so that's the pus forming. The mucus forming foods are going to be your starchy vegetables and fatty fruits or fatty vegetables, you know, anything in that vegetable world that's like that. Now, with the mucusless diet, we're not hardcore about the raw, like, say, you know, sort of a raw foodist would be, where within the mucusless diet healing system, you combine raw and cooked, particularly mucus-free cooked items, to advance yourself down the path to get cleaner and cleaner and get to higher levels, so that you can eventually get to where you can really sustain a truly, if you so desire, where you really can sustain a raw, a mucus-free raw diet, you know, raw mucusless diet, you know, or period. But it's always about kind of going through these different periods. Like, you don't have to sustain one thing forever. You know, you hit the mucus-free period, you fast for a little bit. You know, take a step back and might have to eat some transitional meals. You know, it's just sort of all of these, using all of these different components as you need to within the context of the system.
Yeah, and I see that a lot in the raw food community, where people will just stick themselves onto one path that they feel they cannot, you know, deviate from, and they end up failing at it, and they go back to eating pus-forming foods.
Right.
And so, you know, that is what I really love about the mucus-free diet healing system, is that system of transitioning. I myself had a pretty good transitional period, and, you know, I'm I'm still not 100% raw. You know, sometimes I'll have some steamed mucusless vegetables. And so I think just having that variety or that cushion that allows you to, you know, work your way into it over time, I think that's so important. And yeah, I mean, I think that's why the Mucusless Diet Healing System is a great path for people to take, that even if they want to get to 100% raw vegan, you know, this is something that they should really get into so that they can reach that level, you know, successfully over the long term.
Yeah, definitely agree with that.
Yeah. So what else is a part of this system? I know there's enemas. You know, what is the significance of using enemas for this?
Yes, the lemon juice and distilled water enema. That's right. You know, our thing. Of course, Eric, the classic one out the book is the water enema. The lemon is maybe that's the one embellishment that we've sort of made to the system. Even though the I know there's an earlier instance of it, but there's an in a book related to Eric, one of Eric's students in her book actually mentions lemon juice enemas. And so that is just so it's still connected to the whole Eric thing. But Eric basically says it's very important when you're fasting, you know, while you're fasting, you want to be doing enemas. You want to keep those poisons moving, cleaning, just get your, you know, basically just keep irrigating your colon, getting that stuff out of there. And when you're starting the transition, it's really important. Now, there's long-term practitioners, Brother Air and myself and Takora and a number of other people that have just made it a daily practice. They just do lemon juice enemas every day. And, you know, of course, it's controversial because it's like, oh, well, you know. But depending on how you read Eric, there's the one connotation is in one section where he's talking about internal baths. He basically says that it's mandatory when you're fasting. You definitely do it when you're fasting because it's really kind of dangerous not to. But it's not harmful and it's advantageous, you know, kind of the more you do it, just indefinitely. And so that's something that within the community, everybody sort of finds their own groove based on, you know, what everybody has talked about they've done. Usually when I'm working with somebody, I tell them to just do one every day for 2 weeks. Give yourself 2 weeks of doing it every day. And then you will get a sense of what it's all about, because you can't just do one or two and really learn anything about it. And if you're a person that is concerned about not having natural bowel movements or something like that, I always say, and it's in the Mucus Diet book, you know, wait until you have a natural bowel movement. Have a natural bowel movement. And then do the enema, which will essentially irrigate and kind of cleanse some of that slimy. Because, you know, when you have a bowel movement, you really shouldn't have to wipe. And if you do, there shouldn't be a slimy residue left behind.
Yeah.
But when you're eating mucus-forming foods or you have intestines that are totally filled with slimy mucus, that's inevitable that, you know, when you wipe, it's going to be slimy. So when you do an enema, you're irrigating and you're sort of getting that slime on out of there. You know, you just sort of just keep on breaking it down. You don't let it sit in there and ferment and get all nasty. You know, it just kind of moves it on out. So we look at it as a just sort of a general hygiene principle, you know, just sort of just like you brush your teeth every day, you need to do your enema. Now, of course, there are specific examples or situations where you would want to hold off or not do enemas as much. You know, if you have really weak adrenal glands or you're, you know, chronic fatigue or, you know, there's a number of situations. But there, you know, I always kind of say, you know, that if you're working with me personally or something or another mucus diet practitioner, they can kind of help you determine if you should sort of take an herbal, you know, the herbal path, if you're too at the beginning, or if you want to jump right into the enema. It's rare when I can't get somebody into them, at least in the beginning, because it is important if you've never done them and you've never really cleansed to get that stuff moving. Now, when you start to combine systematically the enemas with improved diet and short-term fasting periods, you know, you start off with 24, 48-hour, juice fast. Mm-hmm. And that's what Eric recommends in the beginning, because we can always get more aggressive. You know, we can always do water fasting. We can always do, there's few people that I recommend investigate dry fasting, just personally, because I've seen what happens when they do, because they're not ready for it. You know, physiologically, they're just not at that level. But most people do not have a problem with, you know, fruit juice fasting or for me, one of the most aggressive fasts is just straight lemon juice. You know, you just juice like two lemons and you drink that down and that's all you have all day. I mean, that's, you know, sort of what I like to get into when I'm in that type of fasting mode. But there's just so many different levels. And there's an article, it's in Spira Speaks, but it's also on the website, where I sort of, in a short paragraph, I explore all of these different possible plateaus of fasting. It's not just one thing. There's all these different levels, and it's different totally depending on your physiology and where you're coming at. You know, what's fasting for somebody else that's just getting into the diet probably is, might not be fasting for me or you. What's fasting for me might not be fasting for somebody else, you know, brother Air or, you know, whoever. So it is, very much based on the relative experience and, you know, physiology of each person.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, what is the typical length of time that most mucusless diet practitioners kind of go with, as far as, do they have a certain length of time that they fast, or?
Well, it definitely changes. It's real specific to each person. Some people find that it's easier for them to fast. Some people have trouble fasting. Mm-hmm. And it also depends on what the person is working on. I'm an advocate for people doing short-term fast in the beginning to basically get the experience under their belt, learn how their body responds and reacts to fasting, and have as close to perfect fasting as possible. And when perfect, I'm talking about getting into it smoothly and getting out of it smoothly, transitioning out of the fast. Is what too many people do is they say, I'm going to go on a cleanse. I'm going to do a 10-day or a 21-day cleanse. I don't even like that word. And they ultimately lose control. They might have felt great the first part of the fast, but then toward the end, as they get closer, okay, I'm going to break this fast. I'm getting kind of hungry. I'm going to eat something. And because they didn't really transition in and out, they probably weren't doing enemas, they totally lose control. And that's worse than if you would have just did a 24-hour fast, broke it successfully, and then just kept eating transitionally. And so, so in terms of length, for me, length is definitely based a lot on your experience. Mm-hmm. If you're working with somebody, you know, I work with a lot of people who I, coach and do mucus-free diet consultations. And there's some people that have chronic illnesses, and I will try to get them to the point where they can do longer fast and it's fairly effortless. Because mm-hmm. I don't like it when where you're like gritting your teeth and you're like trying to force yourself. What happens is, as you start to cleanse yourself, at some point your body is going to start going through some kind of elimination. Some people call it healing crisis. Some people, whatever, there's different words for it. We call it elimination, or intense elimination if it's a little bit more than the normal experience. But you get the cold and flu-like symptoms, you get the fatigue and all that. So I try to get people prepared for that. You can't get around that. There's no pill or no diet that you could practice where you're going to go around that. Now, with the Mucus-free Diet Healing System, you can learn how to gracefully move through it and use it to your benefit. So that's your body's cleansing process. That's the natural process your body is trying to eliminate and throw out all of the nastiness. So it, you know, body heats up. That's a great thing. You know, fever, that's a good thing within this context, because heat the stuff up. A lot of mucus will probably loosen up. You'll start blowing your nose all the time, and you're just getting that stuff out of you, and that's so important. So what I say is, if you do short-term fasting as Eric prescribed, and you start to kind of build yourself up more and more long fasting, and then be prepared for the moment when you start to get into a healing crisis, then fast until it's done. You know, you just, you'll keep the animas going. And what ends up happening is a healing crisis will might take you into a 2 week or a 3 week or even longer fast. And you will not have tried to do that. You will just be listening to your body, because your body is saying, okay, this is what's going on right now. You're going to go through this intensive healing process, and when you come out the other side of this, you're going to be a changed person. But there's some people that try to fight that, because one, it really does transform you. I mean, you can, one of these sort of healing crisis fasting periods, you can totally transform your life, you know, in a matter of days or weeks, just if you really stick to it. But there's also a lot of cultural stuff, and that's something that I've talked a lot about, and I'm going to do more discussions about that. But we like to talk about pus and mucus culture, and do sort of, you know, an anthropological analysis of the society based on a mucusless diet filter. And so, just as something as simple as you walk down the street, what do you see? Look at the way that they advertise food. You know, these big, I mean, every day we see it. Before the mucusless diet, or before a certain level of health consciousness, most people don't even really think two thoughts about it. They just see, oh wow, Subway sign, or McDonald's, or they might not eat. That's subconsciously, they're not even really consciously seeing it. But then when you start practicing a diet, or you sort of get a little bit of health conscious, you walk outside and it's like, it's just like, it's basically the experience of, if I hope that, you know, the viewers know this movie, but you know, Back to the Future 2, when when he comes back from the future, and because of things they did, everyone's all messed up, and he's like, this is not. And that is the closest way that I could describe the experience of, once you get into the diet, then one day you walk outside, or you turn on the TV, or you online or whatever, and you're just like, this place is just totally obsessed with pus and mucus, and it's just based on it. And and so that cultural understanding helps us, on one level, it helps us understand how deep our addiction to mucus-forming foods is and why it's like that. Because we've been programmed since we were little children to just, you know, this is what it is, you know, McDonald's and Happy Meals and Burger King. And then you start to see the absurdity with it, because a lot of, when they're selling fruit and vegetables, it's almost like those commercials are somewhat serious. You know, they're not real goofy and silly. It's like even Chiquita Banana, that's not really silly. It's just it's just a kind of a cute little kind of jingle and stuff. But when you look at pus and mucus, especially pus products, the way they try to sell them,
cartoons and happy songs,
happy songs and crazy characters, and you know,
toys
and just. Just very adolescent, and it speaks to that level of dietary consciousness, you know, where it's just real kind of base, you know, just this base level sort of, you know, experience, and people get swept up in it. You know, me and Brother Erwin, one time we was driving, and you can see people driving down the street and then stop as if they're going to turn into a restaurant, and then sit there, and then sort of keep going, and then turn into the next restaurant. So it's so it's like they're going through this process in the moment of, oh, I want to eat here. Oh, wait a minute, that's up there. And there, it's and there they go. you know, you go there. It's, but you would never really observe something like that unless you were really into what we're talking about, you know, really get that, that pus and mucus paradigm.
Yeah. Yeah. A good example of somebody that didn't transition correctly, I think, would be Ashton Kutcher. Back, you know, what was it, a couple of years ago, mm-hmm. when he when he had his little pancreatitis attack or whatever, and he tried to go all fruit, and I can only imagine what his lifestyle and diet is like, and the media to spin that and make it look like, you know, eating a fruit diet is gonna kill you is basically how they kind of use that.
Yeah, that was crazy. And I wrote an article about that one because I was just like, nah, this is. And it got. And the funny thing was, it sort of gave a little publicity to Arrett and to all. Because it was kind of like, well, who's Arrett? What? Arnold Arrett.
Yeah.
You know, so people were kind of looking into it and stuff. And so I was kind of got a little bit of mileage out of that. But yeah, that was. I might even posted something on his on his Facebook page or something. I was like, man, you didn't. You really needed to transition. I don't know what you was thinking. Because in his comment, he said something like, Arrett, you know, oh, he must have been misinformed. Like, what are you talking about? You didn't even obviously read the book. You are misinformed.
Exactly.
Crazy. So, but that's. But the sad thing is so many people do that, you know, for whatever reason. And all I ever talk about, because I could talk about a lot of different subjects, but the main thing I focus on is transition diet because so few people focus on it and talk about it. And so so I kind of a broken record on that subject, but I feel like I have to be because there's still that happens so much. I come across so many people that have that sort of experience of, they were into something that was before they got into the Mucus-free diet, where there was some, you know, so a raw food thing or a fruitarian thing or even different vegan things or cleanses or whatever. And it was always predicated on something other than fasting, or I mean something other than transition. So that feels like that I'm always kind of repeating that message. Like, look, it's okay to transition. There's nothing wrong with I'm not saying go slow, but I'm also not saying that you have to push yourself to so fast that you got to feel like you're where, you know, different people have been practicing a long time. Like you have to be where they're at tomorrow. That's one reason why I don't talk a whole lot about what I'm eating day to day, not because I want to like be secretive or not tell people. It's just because people want to try to do what I'm doing. If I say what I did the past couple weeks, people probably try to do it. And I'm like, I don't really want to, like, you don't have to, like, you do your own path. Like, just because the principles, what got me to this point. And dealing with the principles and each day, you know, some days are better than others. So that's sort of been a pedagogical challenge of, you know, the Mucus-free Diet Healing System and how to really, you know, show people the lifestyle but understand the changing dynamic, how the way you practice in year one, year two, year three is quite different from year 10, 11, and 12. You know, it's always changing. It felt like I sort of became a new person every 3 years because my consciousness would change. I would look different physiologically. Every 3 years, I pretty much would sort of go through some kind of transformation. And so you're constantly evolving and changing. And so you, but that's something that, it's hard to consider that, I think, for some people because they want to know what's the final destination. Where are we trying to go? And it's like, well, that's, I'm not going to tell you what the final destination is. That's for you to discover. I can give you the principles and a path. And then the rest is your self-discovery of, you know, based on your physiology, your own aspirations. You know, what do you want to do? You know, what are you trying to become? You know, it's not for me to say or to tell anybody, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, it seems like our society, because it's gotten so fixated on quick fixes and having immediate results, surgeries and all these things. I think that plays into a lot of why, people just want to jump right into the expert level and they don't want to take it at a not so much a slow pace, but at a conscious, intelligent pace, that's going to allow you to, succeed long term. But that is just the society we live in at this point, unfortunately.
That is true.
So, if someone wants to start practicing the Mucusless Diet Healing System, what would you suggest that the first couple steps they take just to prepare themselves and kind of start getting into it?
So step number one is, get a copy of the book. However you get it, of course, I promote the annotated, revised, and edited edition. A lot of the people that have read both the original text and my text, or my edition, say go with my edition because it has the original text with a few necessary edits to sort of modernize it just a little tad bit. And but then there's commentary. So it's like if you've come across something like an annotated Bible or an annotated piece of literature where in the at the end of the chapter they sort of talk about things or in the margins or something, they have a running discussion that analyzes the text and the different layers of meaning and that kind of thing. And so we have that. So that would be the first thing I would do. Then the next thing is once you read the book, then you sort of have the foundation for the next steps. And the next step is if there are questions that you have after you read the book, then you want to seek people out. Whether you go, we have a Facebook forum, and if you really want to join, send me a personal message on Facebook, and then I'll add you. There's a lot of people that have tried to join, but I had to kind of slow down letting people in because it was just I didn't want to lose control of it like I've seen a couple other groups lose control because there's too many people coming in and not enough education going on. So I really slowed that down. But if you want to get in right away, then let me send me a message and I know you're serious and let you in. But but yeah, once you read the book, you can kind of join the group and get that kind of support. Depending on what you're going through, I'd recommend working with some kind of practitioner. Mucus's diet, I'm one of the only ones that really is 100% Mucus's diet. Like that's what I do with the people I work with. There's a lot of folks that might know of the Mucus's diet, but they'll sort of say that they're coming at it from a different angle, whether it be detoxification specialist or if they come out the Morris tradition or the Dr. Sebi tradition or whatever. They're kind of, they know of Eric's work, but they're not, that's not their thing. They're sort of coming at this other angle. But my thing is, whoever you seek out, just it's good to get that help if you need it, if you're serious. I was lucky that when I got in the Mucus-free diet, I was around people that had practiced it quite a long time that lived, up the street. And so I sort of had, Brother Air, aka Willie Smart, and his family and some other people that was living in Cincinnati at the time. We it was just a small little community of people, and this was before a lot of the internet stuff, way before the Facebooks and all this kind of thing. So I just immersed myself into the community and the local community and the diet, and I just learned a lot from just that immersion. I try to not replicate that experience, but pass along those kinds of things that I needed when I started the diet. If I'm working with somebody one-on-one, or if I'm some of the things I'm working on an e-course that I hope to have out in the next month or two. And so some of those kind of details are going to be in there. It's going to be kind of walk you through the entire Mucus's diet healing system and give you the basis and the foundation to take things in the next level. But number one, read the book. Spira Speaks has the lemon juice enema instructions in it, so I would say get that book too and check that out. That's it, toward the beginning in the first volume, and then get yourself an enema bag, and just get be open minded. You know, when you read the book, when you go, just you don't have to agree with everything that Eric says to practice the Mucus-free Diet Healing System. And because I don't agree with everything that Eric says. But that doesn't change or affect how I practice a diet, you know, because Eric comes from a tradition of writing that's a bit, I'm going to say antiquated. I mean, it's just a more old school approach where there's philosophy that's embedded into the practical information. And I think that throws a lot of 21st century readers, because they're used to sort of this idea of scientific writing where it's what, and it's not really, and that's not even real science, what a lot of people think is. You know, they're like, well, that's not scientific. It's like, yeah, but well, which medical journal are you reading? Or science journal? Or because we can have a conversation about specific articles or whatever, but nobody does. You know, they're reading something off of BuzzFeed or something, you know. Yeah. Like, so I'm just that kind of gets all nerves. Like, look, man, we gotta sort of elevate our whole discussion when it comes to that kind of thing. But with Eric, what we're basically saying is it's not about science, it's about art. So you would be better to think of the Mucus-free Diet Healing System as an art form. And where when you learn how to play an instrument or you learn how to draw, you study the principles, and that's what the Mucus-free Diet Healing System book is. It's the principles of transition, a little bit of philosophy to throw in there just to sort of, you know, just start to transform your consciousness a little bit and, you know, expand your horizons a little bit. Mm-hmm. And but then you are responsible for taking those principles and practicing them to turn them into something for yourself. And that's what every musician does. They go to a teacher, and the teacher gives them the fundamentals and gives them a little bit of, you know, life lessons, philosophy stuff. And then, but you are responsible for practicing 8 hours a day if you want to become a really good musician or whatever it is. And so that's the framing I try to apply for people to the Mucus-free Diet. Look at it, because the majority of people that read the Mucus-free Diet book are not scientists. They don't publish in scientific journals. They've never read a scientific journal, and they're peer-reviewed studies. I mean, they don't, you know, yet they're still using that sort of concept and that term. You know, mm-hmm. Eric, like Leonardo da Vinci and some of these other individuals, there was a tradition of artists that were, you were sort of all of the above. You were like an artist and an inventor and an engineer and a philosopher and a spiritual, theologian. And, you know, just all of the above. You were concerned with, you know, the Renaissance person, as they might call it. And that's really what Eric was, you know, a true Renaissance man of his era. And it comes through in his writing. And so it's just important. Just keep that open mind when you're going through it, and just be ready. You know, be ready to work, and because it's serious business. I'm not gonna say it's not easy. You know, it's not an easy path. But the little bit of wisdom that I've realized sort of from the beginning was that just because it's not easy doesn't mean that when I'm in my 60s or 70s, if I even get that far, that experience is going to have it easy, to feel easy now, that when it really gets hard in my 60s or 70s, like that would be warranted. What I realized was you can either go through these eliminations at a younger age now, or you can wait until you're sort of the last 10 years of your life, or your when you're waiting on your deathbed to kind of go through them. I would prefer to go through it with a little younger body and you know, go through it now. And you will actually, and people don't like to go through that stuff sometimes, but you'll start going through illnesses that you probably would have had, or not even probably, that you would have had. They would have expressed themselves later down the road differently. I mean, I've gone through things that I was like, man, I feel like I'm like a day where I just feel elderly or something. I'm like, what? It's just an elimination. Then the next day I'm back to feeling like a kid again, you know. But that is sort of the art and the science of this whole cleansing process, and you know, reconstructing our bloodstream. You know, we're reconstructing our bloodstream and our physiology, you know, the emotional component, because that's a whole other subject, but it's not really, it's all hooked into this, because as you start to cleanse and fast, a lot of your old emotional stuff comes up.
Yeah.
And that is, you know, I advocate something called the Sedona method to deal with that, although I'm aware that there's a whole lot of systems of emotional release and meditation traditions and neuro-linguistic programming traditions, you know, all this kind of stuff. The thing that helped me was Sedona method. I also now offer my own sort of guided releasing sessions for, you know, people that might be interested in work with me. I just studied a lot of these different things, hypnosis, all these different things, and kind of put it into one system. But
cool, but
yeah, so that's basically what I say. Just get started, you know, get the book, just be ready to have your life transformed. I mean, if you're not ready to be transformed, then this probably isn't the path for you, or at least you're not ready yet. But that open-mindedness and the willingness to really transform, if that's what is necessary, that is it's kind of the prerequisite, I think, for going down this journey.
Yeah. And maybe even if you're not ready now, buy the books now.
Definitely buy the book and read it. Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Sit on the shelf and you pass them every day, and then, you know, eventually you'll pick it up and read it.
Yeah, yeah. And I've done that with, well, especially when you get sick, because I've seen that with people where they're, some of the people that were the meanest to me when I talk about the diet, and they're like, oh, that's crazy, blah, 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 blah. And then I'm just like, all right. And a year later, they're like, hey, man, tell me about that diet thing you was talking about. What was an enema bag, you know, because they're sick and they're all laid up and, you know, mucus is coming out of them and stuff. And they're like, what was that mucus thing you was talking about? I'm like, yeah, you know.
And, exactly. So,
you're right. Definitely, yeah, get the book and read it. And I tell people that are real, I mean, some people are just real passionate about not giving up meat, which is just, that's their addiction talking, but they're just so... You're like, you know, I'm just not going to get rid of it. I'm okay, but then do this. Read the Mucusless Diet Healing System book like you would read a piece of philosophy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a philosophical book. If you read Plato or you read Aristotle or whoever, read it like that and just sort of look at this dietetic philosophy, philosophical perspective, and allow that to do whatever it will to your consciousness. But you don't have to commit just because you're reading it. You don't have to commit to like, well, I got to do it, you know, just
right.
Just
It's like, it's like when, like you said, people will say, well, I love pizza too much, or I love bacon. And it's like, you think I didn't love pizza or bacon? You know, I was there too. So I've been on both sides. You know, you might want to at least just give it a try or read it and just see what resonates with you. But yeah, people are pretty set in their ways.
Exactly.
Yeah. All right, cool. So, again, where can people go to find Arnold Errett's books and more information that you're putting out and some of the different resources?
Okay. Mucusfreelife.com. That is my main website and hub for all of our things. We just released the new design. So you can go to the website, and it's got a nice new design, and things are organized well.
I love the website, by the way.
Ah, thank you, thank you.
Yeah.
And so, and then you wanna, when you go there, you'll see some forms where you can sign up for the Mucus-Free Life Insiders Club. You want to do that because we share coupons and announcements and all kinds of stuff in there. So you definitely want to do that. And you know, we have a presence online. I have Professor Spira fan page and Mucus's Diet Healing System support group, and you know, you can kind of do some searches there on air at fan page. You can, you know, kind of find out some of those things if you're on there. We have everything available now in our store. All the paperback books, we got paperback, Kindle edition, PDF editions. We also have, we just released a line of jewelry, mucus-free jewelry. It's a lemon line. You see, there's a little lemon on here. and so as Janan Al-Jahani made these, practitioner of mucus diet in the community. And so we are, you know, just taking, you know, trying to take things to the next level, but so you can kind of plug in, you know, a lot of opportunities to plug in, YouTube channel, Professor Spira, you know, you check that out. And, yeah, that's, you know, just plug in.
Awesome. Well, thank you very much for coming on and sharing your knowledge and experience with Arnold Lambert's Mucus-free Diet Healing System and all the different things that you've learned. Very inspirational. And I hope that everybody watching this will go out, check out your website, check out the books and everything, and just really just give it a shot. Just try to, you know, take in some of the information and see what resonates with you. And I think that it'll really benefit a lot of people. So thanks for keeping his work going and really adding on to it and making it a good thing for everybody.
All right. Thank you, Matt, for having me on.
Yeah. All right, guys. Thanks again for watching. And always remember to follow your raw intuition.